Hello, and welcome to Advising for Future Ready Careers. My name is Jennifer Kirk. I'm a school counselor and leader in Pennsylvania, and I'm a computer science enthusiast. It's my pleasure to bring you the 18th webinar in this series hosted by NCWIT, Counselors for Computing. Each month, we connect you with the thought leaders at the cutting edge of technology. This series offers a unique opportunity to dive. Dive into the intersection of computer science with traditional and non-traditional STEM fields, also known as CS+X. Throughout the presentation, we would love for you to submit questions through the Q&A feature on the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. We will also be sharing resources in the chat feature, also found on the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. The National Center for Women in Information Technology, NCWIT, is a nonprofit community of more than 1,500 universities, companies, nonprofits, and government organizations nationwide. NCWIT equips change leaders with resources for taking action in recruiting, retaining, and advancing women across the entire computing ecosystem. Before NCWIT, program focusing on women and computing existed mostly in isolation, without the benefit of shared best practices, effective resources, communication with others, or national reach. Today, these programs are part of the NCWIT community, creating a far greater impact than if institutions acted alone. Counselors for Computing, C4C, is one of the programs in the NCWIT K-12 Alliance. The NCWIT Counselors for Computing program provides information and resources that help counselors join the front line of the computing conversation. We bring people and programs together with professional development, knowledge, and resources to give all students access to transformative computing careers. We wouldn't be here today without the support of our sponsor, the Department of Defense STEM, the largest employer of scientists and engineers in the nation. DoD STEM offers educational programs, internships, and scholarships for students and many career development opportunities for educators. We shared their website in the chat for you to learn more. With great pleasure, I would like to now introduce our speaker, Dr. Carlotta Berry. Dr. Berry is a professor in the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering at Rose Holman Institute of Technology. She is the 2021-2024 Dr. Lawrence J. Giacoletto Endowed Chair for Electrical and Computer Engineering. She has a bachelor's degree in mathematics from Spelman College, a bachelor's degree in electrical engineering from Georgia Institute of Technology, a master's in electrical engineering from Wayne State University, and a PhD from Vanderbilt University. It's a lot of school, Dr. Berry. She's one of a team of faculty in ECE, ME, and CSSE at Rose Holman to create the first multidisciplinary minor in robotics. She is the co-director of the NSF STEM Rose Building Undergraduate Diversity Program and advisor for the National Society of Black Engineers. She was previously the president of the Technical Editor Board for the American Society of Engineering Education, Computers and Education Journal. She has a special passion for diversifying the engineering profession by encouraging more women, marginalized and minoritized populations to pursue STEM degrees. Today, she's going to share more about this purpose with robotics education, engineering education, and human-robot interaction research to bring more people to STEM. I'm very excited. I'm sure you all are as well. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Berry.
Thank you so much for having me. I am so excited to be here. So I will now present Robotics for STEAM. And my full talk title is Using Robotics to Encourage More Diverse Populations to Consider Careers in STEAM. I am now going to share my screen. And talk a little bit about my purpose. But before I do that, I would like to thank the entire community for having me today to discuss some of the things that I do in order to diversify STEM as well as STEAM. So I get asked this question a lot, so I always start with my journey to STEM. My journey to STEM was not a traditional one. I was the youngest daughter of a kindergarten teacher. So my only desire was always to be a teacher, and I loved to give my dollies homework and then to grade their homework. By the time I got to high school, I wanted to be a high school math teacher. I had a career counselor tell me, with all of your expertise and love of math and science, you really should consider being an engineer. Unfortunately, due to my age at the time, there were no cell phones, no internet being actively used. So the question is, what is an engineer? I did not want to be a train conductor. So the first thing I had to do after school is I had to go to the library and learn what an engineer was. I always like to say that my journey to STEM was not a broken or leaky pipeline like we typically hear, but it was more of an obstacle course. And through that obstacle course, I had to learn to navigate a lot of difficult things. So I like to say being good at math and science is not enough, but your love of math and science is the beginning to your journey to STEM. But it's also about being disciplined and dedicated and continuing to move forward no matter what you face. So one of the things I share a lot with my students is you need to know your resources and you need to have a community of support and a network to keep you going when things are not quite as easy as you would imagine them to be. So the big part of what I do is because my journey did get me there. I navigated through all of the moats and the alligators and the darts and all of that. But when I got there, I noticed that we still had this stereotype for what an engineer looked like and how an engineer acted. And so one of my biggest goals is to use robotics to diversify STEM so that we can take STEM from looking traditionally like this or what people expect it to look like to this. Hashtag I Look Like an Engineer was a campaign started by Isis Winger in 2015 after a campaign when her husband posted posters of engineers on the Bay Area Rapid Transit System. And when her poster was put up, there was a lot of pushback at the company because they said she's a model. There's no way she's really an engineer. Engineers don't look like her. This is Isis over here in the corner. And she started the hashtag I Look Like an Engineer campaign, which went viral. So our goal is to make sure that when young people are asked to draw a picture of an engineer or to draw a picture of a scientist, they're just as likely to draw a man as a woman, a person of color as a white person or anything like that, an able as well as a person who may not be able-bodied, et cetera. Because we like to say that since engineers design the solutions to the processes that impact the world, engineers need to reflect the diversity of the world in order to make better, unbiased, diverse solutions that more people can use. So what defines me as a professor after my journey through engineering to become an educator is my intersectionality. I like to share with people that when I walk in the room, I don't walk in the room as just an engineer, but I walk in the room as a mother, as a daughter, as a wife, as a sister, as a Black person, as a woman, and all of those things create the engineer that I am, and they're all equally as important, and that's part of my intersectional personality. Ernest Boyer states that the work of a professor has to be separated into these four separate but overlapping functions. I don't just teach, but I talk about the applications of robotics. I talk about the integration of robotics between multiple disciplines, as well as the scholarship of discovery, how I use robotics in order to do research. He proposed that there must be a more inclusive view of scholarship where these four dynamically interconnect to make a dynamic interdependent whole. So the scholarship of teaching, application, integration, and discovery, I feel goes beyond the classroom. So this knowledge is required through research, synthesis, practice, and teaching, where I'm educating future scholars to transmit and transform and extend knowledge. I do this through robotics. I apply that to consequential problems and service that the world would care about. In other words, it's not just robotics for robotics' sake, but you're doing things to try to improve the society that we live in. So the synthesis is where I make those connections across a lot of disciplines, thinking about that STEAM that I talked about earlier, where you add arts onto science, technology, engineering, and math, and then also do investigative research. So I like to say, I bring robotics to STEM to educate people, and I bring people to robotics and STEM to educate and diversify the profession. And this is the way that I create my interdependent whole. And I gave this a name, is what I named my business. I came up with this vision during the pandemic when we were all home for all those months. And I like to call this a noir STEMinist. And that's the way that I define bringing people to STEM through robotics and bringing robotics and STEM to people. The reason why robotics is a great tool for doing this is because robotics is inherently multidisciplinary. Robots already have mechanical features like gears, motors, et cetera. They already have electronics like sensors or a brain or a microcontroller. They already have software as well, like programming it, which computer scientists or software engineers do. And obviously a robot can't do much without interacting with the world, which typically means somewhere in there, you're gonna have humans as well. Biomedical engineers may use robotics for assistive technologists. Psychologists and sociologists may design robots that are gonna work with people, as well as to see how people react to the robots to make sure that they're comfortable. So these multidisciplinary connections are the ideal way that robotics can be used for STEAM. So the first one we think about is science. If you think about a robot and you're thinking about young people, how could you use a robot to motivate science for young people? Well, robots have to move, so they have a speed. How fast is it going? Velocity, is my robot going forward or backwards? Is my robot spinning left or right? Sonar is when you put a distance sensor that uses sound, like the Doppler effect, like how bats or dolphins communicate, to have a robot navigating the world. Or infrared sensors use speed of light to avoid obstacles. So we see that there is science all over robotics. And here's an example. That is a sonar sensor in front of the robot. And when I put the box by the robot, it's trying to move away. So if it detects the robot on the front, back, left, or right, the robot moves front, back, left, or right, trying to get away. So a simple example of obstacle avoidance and science by using a sonar sensor. Technology. So another way to motivate young people to get excited about technology is talk about some of the great ways robotics helps the world. For example, we have Da Vinci surgical robots that can be used for things such as heart valve repair. We have industrial or robot arms, which can be used in manufacturing facilities, such as to help assemble a car in a manufacturing plant. I used to work for Ford Motor Company, so I saw a lot of industrial manipulators in my past life. Assistive robotics, which I've already mentioned for biomedical engineers, for example, where if you have someone with limited mobility, you can design robotics arms and things like that that can help someone to be able to pick things up. We had one at my school where we added assistive technologies to a young man whose arms were too short, so they could actually extend his grasp. Or museum robotics. You could have social robots, which are used to interact with human beings on a daily basis, such as in a museum, to serve as a tour guide. And arts. So the ways that robotics can be used in arts. So I have one daughter, she's a freshman in high school, and she's been doing STEM probably since she was 3 or 4 years old, but right now she's really excited about art. So one of the things I like to share with her, because I do find in research that young women typically drift away from STEM more towards arts and other areas around sixth or seventh grade, is to talk to them about how you can have a love for both of your things. You can marry STEM with the arts and continue to do what excites you. For example, you could design a drawing robot. You could have a robot that plays music, or you could have a robot that dances. So when I do robotics workshops and seminars for young people, I try to always share some of these things as well, so they don't think they're limited in their ability to be able to do robotics because they're not really into science and math. They're more an artsy person. Well, robots are a great way to show some of those connections. Here is one example of a young lady from a camp that I did who programmed her robot to draw by dropping a pen in the middle.
Yeah. Did you put a pause at the beginning? Yep, I guess you did.
And it's kind of hard to see, but she actually programmed the robot to draw a figure eight. And then later she does a house and some other things. All right. So just because you draw doesn't mean you're out of the robotics game. Another example, and this one I did with college students, is I gave them a piece of music and then they had to design their robot to interpret that. So robotic dancing is also a thing.
Let me know if you mind me videotaping.
Kind of hard to hear the music, but trust me, the robot is dancing to music. The robot is actually playing its own playlist, but it's kind of hard to hear in the video. So once again, another artistic expression that you can make through robotics. And math. Obviously, engineering and math and science and technology are closely tied together. So I love math. What can I do with robotics? Well, there's a lot you can do with robots. But I have given workshops for middle school children where we talk about some of the basics. If you know the circumference of your robot's wheel and you know how far your robot moves forward, you can figure out the robot's distance. Or if you know how long your robot moved and the distance, you can figure out the robot's speed as well as velocity if the robot was moving forward and backwards. So let's see what this looks like. So one engineering at Rose Hillman Institute of Technology. So some people call me a one second. But where I was before, I do apologize. So one formula we use for motion is distance equals rate times time. So if I have a robot that's moving at half a meter per second, and I want the robot to move 2 meters straight ahead, how long is it going to take for that to happen?
So time is equal to distance over rate.
So you would have 2 divided by 0.5, and you would say that it's going to take about 4 seconds. Or let's say I'm trying to figure out the speed the robot needs to move at in order to go a certain distance. So I want the robot to move 5 meters in 10 seconds. So what rate or velocity should I give the robot?
So rate or speed is equal to distance over time, which equals 5 divided by 10 or 0.5 meters per second.
So yet again, another example of how you can use robotics to motivate some of these topics that students do. So now I'm going to transition a little bit from STEAM to some of the other non-traditional ways we can encourage young people to consider STEAM. So the epiphany that I had once again during the pandemic, it was a very exciting time for me to get a lot of reflecting done, was to take robotics out of the classroom. I have done service for years and years, but I wanted to come up with some more non-traditional and unique ways to get more people, young and those not so young, excited about robotics and their potential here. So my students have been getting the benefits of me doing STEM, as well as these few young people when I did these workshops. So the way that I did that was taking the robotics out of the classroom by serving as a first robotics judge, advisor, and competition organizer, serving as a robotics coach for my daughter's Girl Scout, Gamer Girls, Vex Robotics, and Lego League teams, as well as other activities. So that now became more unique ways for me to show the exciting opportunities available to people to explore in STEM. And one of the ways I have done this is through social media, as well as 2 organizations that I helped co-found, including Black in Robotics and Black in Engineering. Through these organizations, we have workshops, we have a social media presence, and we do virtual things on Zoom where we ship people kits and we walk to them through how to build a robot, how to program a robot. And we've done this, like I said, for adults as well as children. And also by sharing a lot of media on social media. So I'm going to now share a little bit of some of the other unique ways that we are working to diversify STEM by getting more people excited about the possibilities. One of them is I do robotics tutorials on YouTube as well as social media. And here is the first one that I ever did.
So we design robots for the three D's. The three D's are tasks that are dull, dirty, and dangerous. The reason we do that is because these are things that are not good for humans. An example of a dull task would be an industrial robot that spends 24 hours a day moving parts or inserting parts, like into a car. You don't want a human doing that all day because they would become bored and start to make mistakes. An example of a dirty task would be a painting robot, because you don't want humans breathing in those fumes all day. An example of a dangerous task would be a bomb disposal robot. I think it's clear why we don't want humans. So these are the things that robots are ideal for.
Then another epiphany that I had is that some basic electronics, a lot of people don't completely understand it. And so at the time, my daughter was in the seventh grade and her science class was studying about electricity, series and parallel. So over dinner, she explained to me she did not understand those concepts and what they mean. So kitchen table circuits is taking whatever you can find in your house and using that to explain some of these concepts. And here is an example. So I want to put my fork and my spoon in series. If they are in series, that means that exactly two things meet at the node, where the straw is my node, and they are end to end. So the current flows through the fork, through the node, into the spoon. So Kennedy, they have the same what?
They have the same voltage.
Series. Series, Kennedy. Just do it again. Okay, so I'll edit it later. So they're in series, so they have the same
current.
They have the same current, but they may not have the same voltage. Why would they not have the same voltage? If what happens? One has a bigger
reaction.
Resistance. So if the fork has a bigger resistance than the spoon, they won't have the same voltage, but because they're in series, the current flows through the straw to the spoon. Got it?
Yes. What does resistance mean?
Resistance means... So as you could tell, I never edited the video because I thought it made more sense to actually show how a kid learns this stuff in real time. So although I said I was going to take her mistake out, I did not. But so most of these are available on my YouTube channel, but these would be other ways of introducing young people to some of these concepts to... get them excited about the possibilities of doing STEM, STEAM, or robotics. Another thing I started doing is when I realized that a lot of social media, like for example, this one I believe is from Twitter, have polls on them, and I make quizzes for my students anyway, it was a natural transition to start to make quizzes. And this was quite a hit in the community, even for people who had no idea about any of these concepts, they love to guess. So I always had the fourth option be something silly for those who knew nothing that they could click on, like still not STEM, in humanities, doing arts, not playing, don't do math, et cetera. But I would say things like, my new robot is holonomic. What does that mean? And here's an example of a poll that got 31 results and 77% of them were actually correct. It means that the robot can move sideways. So I also do this on social media as well to get the community excited about STEM, because if they are excited, then the young people in their lives, they can help them to be excited as well. Then I had a request from a colleague who teaches first year students to say, what kind of advice would you give to new students coming into engineering? And that inspired my other series, which is called Engineering Professor Advice, also available on my YouTube channel, where as I think of things that I say to my students, say to my first year students all the time, they got turned into TikToks and other videos. So here's one of the first one of those that I made.
So good day, lovers of STEM and lovers of learning. Here's my advice for today. I did not have a traditional path to engineering. My mom was a kindergarten school teacher, so I didn't take TVs apart with my dad in the garage. I didn't work on cars. I didn't know any of that kind of stuff. But one thing I will encourage those of you who want to go into engineering is learn to be a tinkerer. What I did do is I used my creative mind on my Barbies, my Barbie dream house, on Legos, on Tinker Toys, taking things apart, putting them back together, figuring out how things work. Those are all important skill sets for engineers that will prove to be very helpful in engineering school. So even if you didn't grow up with a parent who was an engineer and showed you how to solder at five, that doesn't mean you cannot be successful. We take non-traditional pathways. They are equally as important because, as I say all the time, diversity in STEM is what we're shooting for. Diversity in mindset, diversity in background, diversity in gender, in race, in ethnicity. So be a creative mind and always be thinking about, how do I solve this? How do I put this together? How do I take this apart? I have more advice for later today, but I want to get into the lab so I can show you on my robots, my next one. Stay STEM-tastic!
So the other one is, how can I do things to get young people excited about the possibilities? So I remembered when my daughter was a lot younger, I used to make up songs to help her learn things, like how to spell her name, to learn her phone number, to learn her address. So if I could take some of these high-level concepts in robotics and turn them into a song or into a poem, that is also a great way to educate the community about what it is that I do. So I have Robot Slam Poetry, and here is an example.
Meet Dr. Martin Luther Zing, a most amazing robot mister. Why is he so cool? Well, that's his two photoresistors. It helps him to see light everywhere he goes. It changes resistance the more the light glows. You can program him to track light, love, and fear. His wheels and motors get those actions in gear. None of this happens without his light following code. Tell me, what did you really think of my robot ode?
So one of my most recent research projects is I became an open source hardware trailblazer fellow, and they actually discovered some of the work that I was doing online, and someone recommended me to apply for this. And so what this is open source robotics, and my project is called Robotics for the Streets, is a way to get robotics into more homes and in more hands by talking about how to design a robot using parts and things that you 3D print or that you purchase from Amazon, Adafruit, or other online websites. And then I started posting videos on social media about how to put the robot together. And the good news is that one high school in Detroit has already built and started using my robots with some students at Martin Luther King High School in Detroit, as well as several other people who homeschool their children are now using some of the resources that I have designed and shared and created to 3D print and build robots with their kids. So my whole vision was to design an open source robot so the entire design is available for anyone who wants it and flexible enough for academics such as professors to also use it for doing service with kids, teaching at the high school or college level, or also doing any kind of research. So because these robots are open source and can be modified or designed or changed based upon the user's needs, they're appropriate for everything from novice to expert levels, K through 12, university or graduate, modular enough to add and remove sensors, controllers, et cetera. And it can be used and modified in on websites like Tinkercad, which K through 12 and elementary children use. You can be programmed in Arduino, which more advanced students can use. They also have online programming, as well as there's some graphical programming that you can use for it, such as Blockly, Makey, or Scratch. And like I said, because it uses off-the-shelf parts, that is then completely up to the user how they want to modify or use it. And here is an example, and actually your second example in this presentation of LilyBot.
Hi, my name is Carlotta Berry, and I'm a professor of electrical and computer engineering and robotics, and I'm also an open source hardware trailblazer fellow. My project is Robotics for the Streets, robots for academics to engage in service, teaching, and learning. And I have created the flower bots, LilyBot, DaisyBot, and RosieBot. LilyBot is my smallest robot and is used for service and outreach, as well as for high school robotics. DaisyBot is my next largest robot and it's used for high school students or perhaps freshmen in college to engage in learning a little bit about STEM and robotics. And RosieBot, which is my research platform robot, which will be used for upper level undergraduates or graduate students to engage in mobile robotics research. And today, we will add a buzzer to LilyBot so that LilyBot can play sounds. Please come along, and I hope you enjoy, and stay STEM-tastic!
So here's the wiring diagram for LilyBot created in Fritzing. The buzzer is at the bottom center of the screen, and the red wire goes to pin 3, and the black wire goes to ground. So here we have LilyBot all wired up. So this is our motor controller, a switch for turning Lily on and off, and the buzzer that will play the sound. Okay, so here's the code for playing the buzzer attached to LilyBot. So the first thing you will see is that we have 4 LEDs on pins 4, 5, 6, and 7 for lighting up the LEDs when the music's playing. Then we have a switch pin at pin 2 for turning the robot on and off, a buzzer pin at pin 3. Then we have all of the motor control attachments that we had from before. So then if we scroll down, we have a new variable called a constant song variable with a length of 18, which means that the song is 18 notes long. We have a tempo set at 150, and then we have the characters for the notes, which represents notes on a music keyboard. So that would be C, D, F, D, A, etc. Then we have the beats for each note that it plays, the same length as the song length. Inside our setup function, we do several things, including setting the switch pin as an input with a pull-up resistor. Then we set the LED pins as outputs. We set the buzzer pin as an output. Then we have some photoresistor and motor controls, which you'll learn about in another video. Then we start the light sequence to indicate that the robot is starting. And then we print DaisyBot begin. Inside the loop, we read the switch pin on and off. Note that if you have a 9-volt battery pack with a switch on it, you don't need to have this part of the code. Then if the switch is on, you play the song, or if the switch is off, the robot turns off and the song stops playing. Under the loop function, we have a helper function play song that is a for loop that is the length of the song length, where it sets the duration for the notes. It also plays each note at that certain duration, or if it's a rest, it rests for that amount. And then it delays based upon the tempo with a brief pause between notes, and then it continues. And note inside this loop, we also have a mod function that plays the LED light sequence based upon which note it's on. Then we have another helper function that sets the frequency for each note. And we have the character names for the notes in the song. And then we have the frequency set at 262 and so on, etc. And then it returns the frequency based upon which note was set to be played. So now let's see what this looks like on the robot. So I hope that wasn't too technical for you, but as I shared a moment ago, if you are doing this with younger kiddos, you can always take out that code. And there are some, at least a couple of basic websites where they show how to do the same programming, but with blocks. And so if you want to start younger kids with the more algorithmic type of programming, you would use those blocks, for example, and they would make blocks to turn the LEDs, light emitting diodes, or the lights on and off, or to make the buzzer play, et cetera. So one of the last things I would like to share is something else that started during the pandemic. I told you that was a good pandemic for me, is I worked with a couple of other Black women college professors in engineering. And one of the things we often talk about is the lack of diversity and the lack of, especially women, depending on which discipline of engineering you're in. Some of them have more women than others. Like example, electrical engineering and computer science, which are the two that I'm probably most closely affiliated with, have the least number of women. You'll find more of them typically in biomedical engineering, civil engineering, et cetera. So one thing that we said, it would really help if we could normalize seeing more Black women in STEM. And so the ways you could do that would be like a YouTube series or a podcast, as we know some of those exist, or in you could also have movies, television shows, you know, the next woman, MacGyver or whatever. So as a very basic level to that, the first thing we said we could start with is just writing books. We, you know, as professors, you write all the time. So we all took our and dipped our toe into fictional writing. And they're called Black STEM romance novels because all of the main characters are women in STEM. So here's my first book that was published in July of 2022. It was called Elevated Inferno, Monet's Moment. Monet is a graduate student in computer science, and she is studying robotics, and she wants to use social robotics in order to help young people with autism. So she wants to design robots that young people could use, maybe along with their counselor or psychologist or sociologist, to help with some executive function skills, like they could play games with the robot, et cetera. And she is on her way to her dream internship to work at a robotics company when the elevator breaks down, thus the name Elevated Inferno. And a firefighter comes to rescue her, and that's Reese, shown behind her in the picture. So obviously Inferno is because he's a firefighter. And then she has to make choices between studying and this new blossoming romance, as well as meeting the demands, the work-life balance of being a busy graduate student in a technical field. And I don't want to tell you anymore, but the book is on Amazon, Kindle, and most recently Audible. And I'm now going to play an excerpt from the Audible book.
Black women in STEM are a rare breed. Unicorns, as they say. When you took my human-robot interaction course, I saw something so special in you. Your inquisitive nature and curious spirit were refreshing, but a rarity for an undergraduate student. Having the honor of sending another Black woman in STEM out into the world means everything to me. Although it may not be fair, we're always judged more harshly, presumed incompetent by some, and subjected to additional scrutiny. We must jump higher and run faster just to get in the room. Black women.
And so with that, I am coming to the conclusion of my presentation. And I wanted to end by summarizing some of my key points. Number one, is robotics is an ideal tool for showing connections between multiple disciplines, skill sets, and interests. At my school, when I teach robotics, I have students from engineering design, biomedical engineering, computer science, electrical engineering, et cetera. They all are able to take my courses with the understanding that they're all coming with different skill sets, different interests, but they can all come together on a multidisciplinary team in order to achieve something great. And the wonderful thing about that is, in order to improve society, we need to have multidisciplinary and diverse teams. So robotics is a great way to bring all of these people together. And it's also great for recruiting diverse populations to STEAM, depending upon what your interests are, what your motivations are, and what you want to do with robotics. I even had a young lady, an international young lady one time, who wanted to do robotics because her parents back home were farmers, and she wanted to find a way to program a robot to help and go through and detect crops that were growing well and going bad so that her father wouldn't have to do it. So whatever you can imagine, and let your imagination run wild, is a possibility and something yet to be discovered and the way that you can use robotics or STEAM to do that. And finally, I always end my presentations with this quote. My first one that I said was, "To whom much is given, much is required." I always start with that one because my journey to STEM was not an easy one, and I need to thank all of the people who helped me give that to get there and to give that forward. And the other one is by Maya Angelou. And it is, "I've learned that people will forget what you said, people will forget what you did, but people will never forget how you made them feel." So hopefully something in my presentation today made you feel inspired and encouraged, even if you don't remember exactly everything that I said or did. And with that, I would like to thank you so much for your attention. There are a number of ways to get in contact with me. So I've put my email, my work email address, my work website, as well as my author website, my business website, and also my handle on most social media, as well as to learn more about the work of Black in Robotics and Black in Engineering. You can go to these hashtags on Twitter or Instagram. And you can also go to blackinrobotics.org or blackinengineering.org. Thank you for your time and attention. And I'm now ready to take questions.
Yes. Wow, Dr. Berry, thank you so much. So great. I was taking notes, so I have some questions to go over, so I will hold on mine until I get through the audience questions. A reminder to everybody out there, please do use the Q&A to submit any questions you have for Dr. Berry while we have her captured on our screen here. First, we have this. You have a quote on your website, "My STEM is for the streets, taking it out of the classroom to connect with people on their turf." You talked about robotics for the streets, but can you tell us a little bit more about this?
So that was a saying that basically means I don't want to limit robotics to the walls of a classroom. So that's what I mean by that is if I do the traditional work of a professor, the only people who now benefit from my robotics or even my STEM knowledge is now my students who pay tuition, my colleagues who go and see my presentations at a conference, or the work that's behind the paywall of the journal that I publish in. Those are the traditional ways that professors typically share their discoveries, their knowledge, et cetera. So me being an open source hardware trailblazer is a way of saying I'm taking my robotics to the streets. So wherever I meet you is where I can share what I do. And in my case, it's typically social media, but also giving Zoom, giving presentations like this. So now all of a sudden, it's not just my students and my colleagues who get that. Because if we're gonna diversify STEM, then it has to be, you have to come out, you gotta go to highways and the byways and look at those non-traditional ways of connecting with people.
Yeah, what I'm hearing you say is increasing accessibility for all.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Great. Okay. So also I hear you on here talking about, do the robots, or you talked a lot about your robots. Awesome, by the way, cool videos. Do the robots you shared integrate with other tools?
It depends on the tool. But what I will always tell you is that since they're open source robots, if you have a tool you want to integrate it with, that's for you, the engineer, to design. So that's one of the flexibilities because I share all the files that I use to create my robots. In fact, I had mentioned the Detroit high school teacher who was using my robots. She decided pretty early on that some of her students were not able to do the Arduino programming. So she took the upper chassis of the robot and redesigned it to add a micro bit, which is a much, much easier tool for doing that. So she did, yeah. So I'm going to say, yes, it should, but you may have to design that integration.
Great, thank you. Okay, next, what advice or support could younger you have benefited from, whether from parents, a school counselor, or any other educator, any person that was in your life?
I think for me, it would have been awesome to see someone who looked like me in that field. I think some of those dark and lonely nights at Georgia Tech, when it got really rough, being able to pick a phone up and talk to a mentor or a role model. And I like to say your mentor and role model does not always have to be same race, same gender, but just somebody to be your cheerleader. I mean, you know, I always had mom. My mom didn't totally understand what I did, but somebody who could just be like, you can do this. I did it and so can you, you know, like one of the things I tell my students now is if you're not doing well, you may fail a class. I failed classes. I took them over, but you used it as a learning experience to build your character. And I always like to say, you got me once, but you won't get me twice. So if I take that class over, I'm definitely getting an A, right? And so I share these things. I'm transparent with my students like this because they like to go, oh my God, you must be a super genius. You have a PhD in engineering. No, I just worked my hiney off, right? Because that's a whole lot more achievable than the sage on the stage who walks in the room and just spouts my knowledge, because someone in the back of the room who's struggling right now goes, well, maybe this isn't the place for me because I'm not like that. So I like to say, wherever you are, the streets, I will meet you there and help you get to where you want to go, because that is so important.
So creating cultures of belonging, again, absolutely. Accessibility, representation.
You make it sound so much better than I do. I'm a
school counselor, you know. That's what I do, right? Yeah. No, but I'm hearing you, and this really—it's so important, so that we can build systems that are accessible for all, right. and those of us who do the work, ensuring that we're intentional about making that happen for our young people, right? Okay. Next question from our audience: is there a good way for your robotics activities to be integrated in a week-long summer camp?
Yes, I actually have done several week-long summer camps. In fact, the video of the young lady drawing with the figure eight, that was a week-long summer camp. So every day we did something different. One day we did drawing. One day they did obstacle avoidance. One day they did line following, maze following. So every day, and if you think about it, it kind of broke down that STEAM that I mentioned. So each day we focused on a different skill set on that robot. So like maybe the very first day, they looked at making the robot dance. And then every day it got incrementally more complicated. That camp that I did, I believe, was fifth through eighth grade.
Fun. So I'm tiering it.
Absolutely. You're scaffolding the knowledge that they have. And obviously it's got to be flexible. You have to start where they are and go from there. If they've never programmed before, you may not get as far, but I feel like any exposure is better than none. So you make lofty goals, and if you have to scale it back, you scale it back.
Awesome. Okay, what about future technology gets you excited? And what do you hope to see for our younger generations? And what are some of your future plans? That's a lot. So let's go for the first one. What about future technology gets you excited?
So it's almost here now, but I live an hour from work. So I'm looking forward to the day that I have my autonomous vehicle so that I can nap on the way to work. Or I can actually prepare for class while the car drives. And I know we already have Teslas and things like that, but I don't think we're quite there yet because folks don't totally trust that technology. And obviously, you know, like I said, my mom's 84. The older they are, the more difficult it is going to be there. But I'm looking for that Jetsons level of robotics where I'm all good to just sit back and chill. And you just let me know when we pull up into the building.
You're not wrong, Mike. I was driving the other day in my car. I took my hands off the wheel, and it's holding me between the lines, my cruise control. It's a newer car. It's crazy. It's not there yet, but I'm with you because I got to work.
That's what I'm excited about. The self-parking. Like I know that already exists, but for this stuff to become ubiquitous and common, that's what I'm looking for. I'm a mobile robotics person. So all that autonomous vehicle stuff, that's my jam. That's what I'm looking for. You know what else got me excited? And I know this already exists too. It's those delivery robots. I saw some of those on the sidewalk the other day. That got me kind of excited.
They're on campuses everywhere. They're so cool.
I love that.
What do you hope to see for our younger generations?
I think they're already doing it. I think their level of technology and experience with it has already surpassed ours by leaps and bounds. Like I think I didn't touch a computer until I was in eighth grade, which is about when they came out, the Apple. My daughter has been manipulating an iPad since she was three. So because of that, their beginning point is already so beyond where we are that I'm excited to see what they will create in the next 10 to 15 years. In fact, giving presentations on robotics to kids is some of the most exciting things to do because they will ask questions adults won't. Can a robot do my homework? Can a robot clean my room? And when you start asking those kind of questions, the next step is not yet, but can you design it for me?
Yeah. Figure that out, kiddo. What are some of your future plans?
Well, a big one for me right now is I'm really excited about this robotics for the streets and getting more of my robots in the hands of people who want to learn something about it and being able to help them to learn at the level they currently can. In fact, last week I shipped out about 30 of my robots to people I met on social media, other professors, school teachers, et cetera. And I'm excited to see what they're able to do and what kind of learning materials they would need in order to be successful with kids or adults. So that's really excited for me. And it's really that streets that I talked about a lot. I think that's why I ended with that, because that's what's got me most excited right now.
It is exciting. Okay, from the audience, great presentation, exclamation point. I was texting my daughter during this presentation. She's a computer science grad student working with robotics and sensory scientists to help individuals with neurological conditions. She also helps run computer camps for female high school students. It is fun to see other women rocking STEM. Exclamation point. Thank you for this. Exclamation point. As I work with my students, I always try to encourage them to explore STEM. Our school, unfortunately, does not have strong options for STEM classes. Going to share your websites with them. I'm always looking for free curriculum to share with my students that they can learn on their own time. Do you have any suggestions?
Yes. So when we do Black in Robotics workshops, Vex Robotics has a really great one. I don't know. I'm going to type a website in here. And I think whoever's running the chat can share it. It's called vr.vex.com. And this is one we use with our kiddos. Like I said, we do most of our workshops online. And so the younger kids, we don't ship kits to them all the time because they need a parent there. But if you go to this website, it has graphical programming and games you can play with the kids. And for some of them, it actually simulates a robot. So like if they write the code, you can see the robot drive around. Jennifer, if whoever's running, please confirm that I typed that in right.
I saw it going, yeah.
Okay, but the great thing about it is they can you can look at the camera view, you can look at the top view, but you do things like robot forward, robot turn, robot do whatever, and the kids actually can see on the screen their code coming to life. Where this came about is that there's a Vex Robotics competition that my daughter used to do when she was younger. They reached out to us when they found out we were doing virtual workshops because they knew they had already created a website that could do that. Another place you can go to have kids play around with electronics is called Tinkercad.com. Tinkercad, they can build electronics to make lights blink, to do the sonar stuff like I showed with the robot. And then, of course, always, not just my website, but there's lots of things on code.org, which you may use some of these already, YouTube, et cetera. But anything where you're getting the kids an hour of code or 30 minutes or 15 minutes, doing something on the computer where they are now becoming creators, not just consumers of technology, is just always important.
Awesome. Okay, what is one of the coolest things you've seen your students do with robotics tools?
They do so much more than I do. They always exceed my expectations. One thing I've told my students is don't ever think of me as a sage on the stage. We're on a journey together and we're learning and teaching together. This was some years ago, probably the first year I ever taught robotics. I didn't realize what they would and would not be able to do. So for their final project, I made it really, really easy. I said something like, oh, just program your robot to follow another robot, you know, using the sensors. And that afternoon, I had some students come to me and said, we just took your robot to our other class because we had to do a final project. And so we just took our cell phone and drove the robot around. Your cell phone? Well, back then it was 2007. So that was like major, major. Now everybody does that because as long as you have Bluetooth, you can make the Bluetooth of your phone talk to the Bluetooth of the robot. But I had some students doing that in 2007 and was like, what? So they always exceed my expectations of what you can do. My most recent students now have figured out a way to not just use Bluetooth to talk to the robot, but to use a software called MATLAB to make a graphical user interface. So as the robot's driving around, it's populating on the screen what the robot is seeing and solving a maze. So some of these things are things I could have never done when I was their age. In fact, when I was at Georgia Tech, the undergraduate students didn't even get to touch the robot. We had to do simulation and the grad students got to touch a real robot. So one thing I did with my students is the first thing I said is you're going to have to touch a real robot because your learning cannot expand if all you do is simulate. Mm-hmm.
It's amazing. Yeah. Some great takeaways for me. Our students are creators, not just consumers, and something we always need to remember. I learn from my students all the time in everything that I do. Mm-hmm. Connections, diverse populations, let our imaginations run wild. These are my notes that I took.
Yeah.
And just your social media presence and how you utilize that. And I mean, just even based on the videos you shared, how you continue to move what's on trend and staying present with contemporary issues to
absolutely
get to the streets, right?
So that people can
really have impact. That robot slam poetry.
Thank you. Wow. I need to make more. I've gotten so busy. I only have about five of those. Like I said, the pandemic was good for all of us. I know people hated being in the house all the time, but I work so much with my students that I just needed that reflection time to really think. And now that I'm back at work and I'm running around like a chicken with my head cut off, it's really hard for me to get the time to do things like that. So that's why I like the pandemic, because my creative juices were really flowing. And I talk to students about that, being able to sit and just reflect on how can I make a process better. Mm-hmm. A big part, you know, thinking, you got your light bulb can't turn on if you don't sit in it for a minute. And right. That is so important.
In the Black STEM romance novels, I mean, I think you're reaching an audience that would never consider the field.
Yes.
It's the coolest thing. And I thank you for all of that, because it helped me really grow tonight. And sadly, that is all we can cover for tonight. Thank you so much, Dr. Barry.
Thank you for having me.
For all of this. We hope everyone out there will join us for our next two webinars in April, or view past webinars by going to a link in the chat.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And thank you, Jennifer. I learned from you as well.
Thank you for saying that. You're so kind. Okay, so finally, look out for a survey in your email, everyone. Within the next few days, responding to the survey will enter you into a drawing for a $100 Amazon gift card and resource kit. We thank you for your responses and for joining us today. We hope to see you at our next webinars in April. And Dr. Barry, applause. Thank you so much. This was a really fun time. We have a cool robotics program here at my high school, and I'm going to tell my robotics teacher all about you.
Please do. Thank you.
Thank you so much.